Well, I want to welcome you to the 2016 Alternative Photography Process Symposium. This is the fourth event, such event that we've put on. We started with the first one in 2010. First 2010 and 2012 were in Seattle. Those are one-day formats, and then we expanded to a two-and-a-half-day format with Astoria, Oregon in 2012, and now here we are with a two-day format in Vancouver, BC. I wanted to tell you just a little bit to set the stage for what is the Center for Photographic History and Technology. So I was at the APHIS Alternative Photographic International Symposium in Santa Fe that Bostick and Sullivan puts on back in 2005. And Dick Sullivan and Melody Bostick came up with the idea that, you know, they really wanted to protect these alternative processes. They wanted them to be archived so that future practitioners would have something to go by. And they also wanted to create a variety of forums so that people could share information and ideas about these processes before they died. Back then, about a decade ago, you know, some things were kind of on a decline, and that was concerning. Digital was just starting to ramp up. We didn't really realize yet how digital could be a part of the hybrid process, capture images digitally, print them with alternative photographic processes. So at the time, that was really their main goal. They had very lofty goals in terms of even extending to a university-style Master of Fine Arts degree in alternative photography. There exists one today done by a college in Boston. But it wasn't Bostick and Sullivan, it wasn't Center for Photographic History and Technology that actually made that happen. So they're not currently active, but what they did was they spun off several chapters. I was so interested that I thought I wanted to form a chapter for the Northwest area, Seattle, Portland, and so on. So in 2007, I came back and did that. I already knew a group of people that would be interested in this, so we started meeting on a regular basis, 3 or 4 times a year. And then I found out there was another group in Vancouver, BC that was already meeting. They had spun out, not related to the Center for Photographic History and Technology, but just on their own. So we joined forces and came up with a larger group. And then we've been meeting. I see a lot of people in the room are from that group, so you know what I'm talking about, but also I want to make sure other people know about that. So if you've registered with us and your email is in the registration information, then I may begin sending you information about these future meetings in case you would want to participate in that as well. So again, it's all about, you know, the print as the physical object. At least maybe I'm imparting a little of my own, you know, philosophy on it. That's what we want to practice. There's a certain aesthetic to these various processes that just can't be replicated with a print that you make on a printer, or at least it's either impossible or very difficult to. So some things are even three-dimensional. We've got some encaustic artists here that will be teaching you about that. There's even more of a three-dimensionality to those type of processes. And that's what we want to help people understand, what it's about, so that you can try it yourself, you can talk to people who are doing it, and just learn more. It's all about learning. So just one note on why Vancouver. So we went south from Seattle to Portland 2 years ago. We wanted to encourage more of that audience to participate. And then now moving north to Vancouver, because we already knew we had a base of people up in Vancouver that were interested in alt photo. So that's why Vancouver. So now I'd like to introduce Philip Chin, who is another one of our event organizers, and he's our local guy here who helped make all the arrangements for this venue possible and quite a bit else. So, Phil, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thank you for coming. This is, like Craig said, this is the first time the symposium has come north to Canada, where all the cool Canadians are. We have the Americans here, which we love. We really love. You can stay if you want. I hear you might immigrate up here soon. I'm hearing that. So I got a small house, detached fit. I can rent it out pretty cheap. So if you want to stay, cool. Again, thank you for coming today. We're going to have a really cool programs over the next 2 days. I'm really excited about this. Talking to Craig two years ago? Sure. 2 years ago, I was so impressed with what happened in Astoria, Oregon, that I really want this to happen in Vancouver, because you know what? We love photography here. We love real, tactile, traditional photography, alternate photography. We love it up here. Well, I love it up here anyways. So I really wanted to have to come up here. So, and thank you to the board for allowing us to do it up here.
That's good.
So right now I'm gonna introduce Joan. She's one of the executive committee members, and she's going to introduce Blue.
Blue Mitchell was born in Montana, but for as long as I've known him and about him, he's lived in Portland.
where he has been involved in many varied aspects of photography and publishing of photographic materials. He has a Bachelor of Fine Arts from the College of from the Oregon College of Art and Craft. Shortly after graduating, he set up a publishing company, 112 Publishing, focusing on, quote, artfully crafted photography. Since its inception, Blue has published a photographic annual, Diffusion, which is internationally distributed and highly respected. It is, in the interest of full disclosure, I had the honor of having two of my photographs included in the inaugural issue in 2009. The publishing company has now expanded with their first monograph called Contact, a collection of Jake Shivery's photographs. Blue is greatly in demand for jurying and curating both at the national and international level galleries. He, in his personal work, Blue is an experimentalist. His interests range widely, and he has been involved in teaching these various processes in several workshop venues in Portland. His work has appeared in several galleries nationally, most recently at the notable Verve Gallery in Santa Fe, New Mexico. He also has work included in several recent publications. It's my honor and our pleasure to introduce Blue Mitchell. Please join me in welcoming him.
Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure being here. Actually, when I was first invited to come, I said, are you sure you want me to do this? And I say that because, in fact, I was joking with Joe, and I said the title of my talk is going to be Alt Process is Dead, just to see what kind of reaction I could get from the crowd. One of the things that I have enjoyed as a photographer is the all the tools that photographers can use to make their work. I find that all the other arts that I've been involved with, I didn't have as many options for tools. And photography is so broad, and there's so many options for photography, that that's, well, number one, why I got into it, but also why I think defining things is kind of silly. Some of this, these are what the actual silver pieces look like. I don't know how well you can see them, but you can see that they have like the resin coating. You can pass these around, you can touch them. I put them on top of the
Quinn Jacobson. Educator, artist, humanitarian, person who gives up his time for someone he doesn't know. If you email him, ask him a question, he'll answer you. No questions asked, no nothing, he'll just do it. That's the kind of person he is. I've known him for a few years. When I first got into Wet Plate, when you Google Wet Plate, who do you get? That gentleman right there. And he's been like a mentor. He has always given me good advice, even though I may not understand it all the time, it's pretty good. So he's been really helpful in my passion for Wet Plate. Now Quinn has been doing this for a long time. I believe it was back in 2006, you went back to Europe. Was it France or where was it? Yeah,
Germany.
And you were teaching, you brought Wet Plate back to Europe. I think it was not common anymore. I mean, it was not as popular as it was now. So you taught, I'm gonna say hundreds?
A little over 1,000.
1,000, okay, about 1,000 workshops.
No, 1,000 people.
Oh, 1,000 people. Well, 1,000 workshops is more impressive. Okay, there we go. Okay, 1,000 people. And that was 2006, and I believe generations have gone by where I guess they've taught their children the next generation. So those people, I'm not sure if they are familiar that you've taught the earlier generation. Yeah, so it's kind of full circle. I'm not gonna say too many more words because Quinn is going to come up, share his experiences. Please enjoy, please learn and enjoy it. And then we'll have a demonstration right after so you get to see him hands-on, live. All right, Quinn, come on up.
Wow, I appreciate it. Thank you. Thanks for that introduction. I thank you for inviting me and having me here. I joke around a lot because I get nervous, right? So I make these cracks and comments, but it's just nerves. Really, I'm a pretty serious guy. And I say this with all sincerity. I truly appreciate it. It's an honor for me to come here. I appreciate you thinking of me. And while I've tried to make an impact in the world of historic photographic processes, it's always an honor to have some group of people or an individual call up and say, hey, would you come out and, you know, talk to us about this? And that's what I'm going to do here today. So thank you for inviting me. I truly appreciate it. My talk really is, I do quite a few of these, and I normally do about a 30 or 40 minute presentation, then do Q&A. What I really want to emphasize here is not so much technical. You'll see the technical. Who's in the workshop next week? Awesome. Thanks for coming, guys. If you really want to know this process and you want to get down to the nerdy organic chemistry and all the subtleties, come and do a workshop with me. I'll blow your mind with that stuff. This is more personal. This is about a direction that I've chosen to take in my photographic career. And I'm going to give you reasons why. And I'm going to give you some opinions on what I think is happening in the world of photography today, photography in quotes, and how it's changing and transforming into something else. And I don't think anyone really knows what that is. But I'm going to talk to you today about three projects that I've done over the last 15 or 20 years. I lost my relationship with photography in the late 90s. I have I always do show you my CV so you kind of know where I'm at, give context to the conversation. My upbringing was interesting. I come from a family of photographers. My father was a photographer. My mother was a photographer. They weren't professional. They were just avid photographers. So photography to me was, I didn't know, not everyone did that. So I'd go to a friend's house and exposure in 3, 2, 1, 1001, 1002, 1003, 1004, 1005, 1006, 1007, 1008. Let's try that on for size, see where we go. I have no idea, guys. I mean, I have some idea, but, you know, that's the fun of it, right? If we want everything perfect, I mean, okay, so. It's amazing what you can, I don't know, this process always trips me out. So unfortunately we don't have cyanide here, but there's the image. Now this is covered with unexposed silver. So we need to remove that unexposed silver. It's not that exciting in sodium thiosulfate, so I'll remove it and then I'll hold it up for you again. Look at that, you'll have a diptych. This is the one I did a fill for the kind of just a demonstration. You know, so people don't say all I do are mug shots. Oh, he must be sensitive about that. Don't mention mug shots around Quinn. Now well guys, I think they're giving me the cue. Awesome, thank you. My pleasure, my pleasure. I don't want Phil's camera to get jacked up here, so I'm going to put these standards.
Don't drop my camera. Don't drop it. Thanks, Quinn. That was amazing.
Thank you.
That was incredible. Presentation, demonstration, the backstories made it all worthwhile. Thank you again.
Claire O'Neill hails from St. Paul, Minnesota. And I hope she likes what I'm going to say, because I had to do some deep mining to get some information. She lives in St. Paul, where she's lived most of her life. She graduated from University of St. Thomas, which is also in St. Paul. She was pre-med and took the med school admission test. Her boredom with organic chemistry and desire for more creative opportunities led her to joke about becoming a mushroom farmer. Instead, she followed graduation from college with the founding of a small business, creating customized tours of Ireland for small groups. This brought her to her budding endeavors with photography, first doing your own promotional images and quickly morphing into black and white fine artwork. Her business acumen earned her an award from the Minnesota chapter of the National Association of Women Business Owners as Young Woman Business Owner of the Year in 1996. Since then, she has expanded her interest in photography as a creative and as an entrepreneur. Her work has been shown and collected nationally and internationally. She is represented by galleries in Aspen, Colorado, West Hollywood, and Minneapolis. Claire describes her work as contemporary photo encaustic. She is inspired by traditional oil painters and uses her photography as the starting point to create works with a three-dimensional quality using beeswax, pigments, and layers of texture. The process adds mystery and timelessness to her work, producing a dreamlike quality that provokes the viewer's level of interpretation. She's going to be teaching an online class beginning in early October, but meanwhile, she's here to tell you about her process and whet your appetite for having your own experience with this multimedia process. Please join me in giving Claire a hearty welcome.
Thank you all for being here. I am not, I will admit at the get-go here, I'm not used to speaking in front of crowds. I do a lot of teaching, so kind of went at this with the whole aspect is I'm just gonna sort of teach you guys what I do, and with sort of the assumption that a lot of people don't know what encaustic is, photo encaustic is from the get-go. So some of you who do know what this is all about, there'll be some sort of beginning stages to it and what it's all about. So I do have notes. So Joan did a great job of actually introducing me and where I came from, what I'm all about. I'll admit as well, I love business just as much as I do the art and photo encaustic. So for me, this is being able to bring two of my things together, what I absolutely love, which is the whole business aspect of this and creating online classes and doing a lot of teaching and marketing my work and all sorts of stuff like that. So. If anyone does have any questions along the line too of marketing and stuff, I'm happy to tell people what I do or talk to me afterwards. I know it can be a difficult thing for artists to sort of think about is how to market their work. So the first thing I actually will do is show you just a quick 2-minute video of me working.
I was fascinated with encaustic paintings the first time I saw them, and knew I wanted to incorporate my photographs with wax. I like that the image now becomes an object of art, hanging on someone's wall and having a life of its own.
Oops.
I apply the wax first and embed a photograph as a top layer. I love being able to run my hands over the image and feel the depth and texture of the work. The space I create around the image isn't real, and it's not part of the original photograph. Isolating the subject and creating my own background allows me to create an image that seems timeless. As viewers, we all bring our own perspectives to the work, and it's ultimately up to us to determine what that space is about.
So that was just a short promotional video I did a couple of years ago. So wanted to show you, I'll be working here for you guys too, but wanted to show you a little bit more about how I work in the studio. So Joan's intro indicated that I did not come to this early in life. I'm sort of much later at the whole photography aspect of things. I did it purely as a promotional for a business that I was running. I needed to go and get those photos of Ireland. So. The old slide film and taking photos for promotion.
So, and when it's fusing, it's shifting a little bit with the wax. It's a molten material, right? So it's shifting a little bit as I'm doing this, which lends that serendipity. So there's a lot of serendipity to this process, which can be really frustrating for perfectionists. But you kind of get the idea.
So where do you live? Is it very hot, humid? Does it affect the conditions when you work?
Yeah, it does. It can be hard when it's really humid and hot. So if it's 100 degrees, I mean, I did with Julie here, I did a workshop in Portland this June, the 100 degree weekend in Portland in her studio. And there was, it just never cooled. It never solidified, you know, it was always just soft. So when we were coming in and you know, using some of these colors and stuff, it just really wasn't working. It was just kind of a mess. So if it gets really hot, if it gets really cold, it's the opposite. It's just, when you're putting it on, it's not, it's just hard to get it. It's cooling between here and here. You're working with a molten material. So temperature does play somewhat a role.
So when somebody buys your work, they have to be careful?
Not necessarily, because it's going to melt at about 160. So you got bigger problems if your room's 160. Yeah. Now the back seat of a car, the back window of a car, is a very bad place to carry.
Well, if you can hang it on a sunshine.
Yeah, like if you live in Arizona.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you don't want to put any artwork in direct light, though.
Don't put it in the sun.
Don't put it in the sun. Yeah, I mean, it will. If I put this in the back of my car and you know, I can, it starts to get a little soft. Does it melt to a puddle? No. It does get soft. Like, it's soft now, a couple hours from now, and especially a couple weeks from now, that'll be rock solid. Right now, it's a little soft, and when I'm doing this and with my fingers, I'm getting a little bit of the, you know, wax off too, because it's kind of smudging a bit. And so that's how I come in with the oil pastels and stuff later. But you could, with the oil pastels, use it as a color instead of using this. You could have used oil pastels, and it's just like all of these different materials can be used in 8 million different ways. But this is how I kind of tend to build my horses. I like to add a lot of drips.
So I met Erin in 2014 in Astoria, Oregon. I saw her work there. She had a table top just like we did here. I was impressed by what she was doing. And I looked at her bio information, which I won't repeat here. We've got a great bio right up in the agenda brochure that we had available for everybody. So she's got a strong background, has work in major collections. But what really interested me about her work was that, and I don't know if any of you fall into this trap, I myself fall into this trap a little bit, is I know how to make silver prints and I know how to make platinum prints. Well, every project must be done in either silver or platinum, right? Well, maybe not necessarily so. Maybe wet plate coating is the right medium for a project. Maybe I should do encaustic work. I don't know, because I haven't tried it. The one thing that impresses me about Erin especially is that she's tried it. She sometimes looks at projects in maybe five or so different media, and sometimes decides that she'll print, like I remember reading about one photogravure project that she printed as photogravure, and then decided it's just not really right, the right look. It's not the right aesthetic for that project. So she tried another medium, and she just keeps trying until she gets it right. And I think in the end, that's going to produce a portfolio of work, a cohesive body of work that's done in the right process. And that lends itself to a much better presentation and overall experience. So with that, I'd like us to give a warm welcome to Erin Malone.
Thanks, Craig. I'm very happy to be here and to share this work, and hopefully you'll find it interesting. I'm going to talk about a particular single project and the journey that I've gone through and that I'm still sort of going through to find its right place in terms of a process. So you're going to see some of the same images over and over and over again. But I started this project, the way I start a lot of projects, I'm not actually doing a project. So in this particular case, I had given myself a challenge to shoot a Polaroid a day. So I was doing a 365 project and shoot Polaroid. And part of that was because I walk my dog every day. And sometimes that's the only time I have to shoot. So, and it becomes this challenge when you're walking through the same area to find something worth photographing and to spend the film on. But during that time, as I was making those images, Polaroid ran out. So Polaroid stopped making the 600. I ran out of my stockpile. And this company called Impossible Project was created. And I thought, well, I'll try that. So I started to shoot some Impossible Project. And I started to see certain images that were rendered well in that film and that I was drawn to. And so I realized that this actually was a project in the making. So I actually started shooting for that specifically. And really the images that I was drawn to that this film seemed to like were these images of fog. I was walking the dog in the morning. I live in San Francisco, and it's sort of part of what we are. So I really liked these images, and in the world of Polaroid, often that Polaroid is a final image, but the Impossible Project film was so unstable and so inconsistent. As you can see, there's blue images, there's brown images, there's black images, there's cases where there's a lot of reticulation, so it was really, really unstable. And but it was interesting, so I kept shooting, and I figured, well, something will happen with this, and I'll figure out how to rationalize this. So I kept shooting, and I've been still shooting, and the images are getting better, the film is better, it's smoother, it's less troublesome, less unpredictable. Here's a couple more images. So these are direct scans from the Impossible Project film. And as you see, it handles a lot of that translucency and the fog and sort of these light, really light grays really nicely. Probably much the same way silver would, but I don't have a darkroom and I don't shoot film. I don't do silver printing, so I have to translate it into something else. So I shoot a lot of Polaroid and a lot of instant film. A couple more. So you'll see these again. So while I was shooting these, I was working on the park project, which I had out on the tables. And so I was making platinum prints. I was working on the portfolio for this body of work. And I thought, OK, I've got this mastered. I think, and I'm making really nice prints, so why don't I make some prints of this fog work? So I started experimenting, and I'm going to pass around some prints. Because I had done the park work on Berger Cott paper, I started there, and I don't know how many of you are platinum printers. Are you familiar with that paper? It's a pretty nice, rich, luscious paper. Pass these around. So these are proof prints, and but still be careful with them. So these are on Berger Cott, and a pretty nice size, 7x7. And you can see some of the artifacting from the Polaroid or the Impossible Project, this reticulation. It's a pretty, I kind of like it. But I've lost something. So I did a couple more experiments. I also do gum over cyanotype, and I was like, well, you know, gum over palladium, that might be kind of cool. But it was kind of a mess. They blocked up too much, and the backgrounds are too many layers. So they, but I'm showing you some of my failures. Actually, I'm showing you a lot of my failures. So I did these experiments. Oops, wrong way, sorry. I think these are all going around. And then somebody recommended, why not try ClearPrint? Are you all familiar with that paper? It's an architectural vellum. It's actually intended for architectural renderings, but it really does take platinum and alternative process materials really well because it holds up. It's very thin, but it holds up in the wash when you're trying to wash. It is not a photographic paper at all. You just buy it at an art supply store in the drafting section. So I got a bunch of these. So I printed on these, this paper. Okay, yeah. I'm gonna switch back and forth. No, yes, not green. Hello? I'll just yell. So I printed on this paper and I really liked it because for some reason it was able to hold some of the lights a lot better. And I took this work to Foto Lucida, I don't remember how many years ago. And it was actually Blue who, when I was showing it to him, he was looking at a stack and seeing how interesting things were happening when you had some translucency. And I thought, well, that's kind of interesting because that really pushes that concept of this notion of the fog and layers of imagery based on that distance and how close you are to it. I didn't really know what to make of it yet, but I kind of liked it. So I did a bunch of experimenting with this. Let me pass those around. And you can feel the difference between the Berger Cott paper. It's much thinner, but it is very strong. It goes through the wash really well. So I've got a couple of those. And the idea of this translucency really intrigued me. So I was like, well, why not just go totally translucent and print on real vellum? So real vellum prints nicely. It doesn't wash so well. You end up the super wrinkle.
Can you flatten it here?
Well, these have been flattened in a dry mount press. And it's pretty contrasty because there's no whites to balance. So it was kind of a fun idea, but it didn't really work. So these are going around. I was experimenting, do I show the edges? Do I not show the edges? You know, sometimes people do want to see the hand of the artist. Other times people want it matted out. And I thought, well, if I could do do the contact print where the edges kind of disappear, maybe that's cool, but I couldn't do that consistently. I'm too messy in my work. Here's a couple of another experiments. And these are the vellum that are being passed around. You know, so if you, as you're looking at them going around, if you've got a couple in your hand, you can see there's some interesting things happen. So the overlapping, which only works with some images. It doesn't work with all the images. But I kind of like that idea. I saw Bill Vaccaro's talk on zeotype. And how many are familiar with zeotype? Just a couple, sort of. It is a palladium process, so it's very similar to platinum palladium. It doesn't have the platinum in it. It was developed by the folks at Bostick and Sullivan, and rather than being a developing out process, it's a printing out process. So that means as you are exposing it, you can check on whether you've got enough exposure. So that meant that I could really work the highlights and these light tonal areas and possibly try to get what I needed. So I ended up printing the rest of the portfolio in zeotype. I did try one calotype, which was a big disaster. So I'll pass that really bad print around.
What paper did you decide on for the end there?
For these, I stayed with the clear print. Because I did like the, even though they were going to be matted and framed, I did like the translucency quality to it because it seemed to hold these lighter grays better than the Berger Cott, even though
in the Park series. That has all sorts of beautiful midtones and lights, but it just didn't print the same. Because I've been showing this work, that's really terrible. Because I've been showing this work at portfolio reviews, I've been talking to a lot of gallery curators and folks from museums. And I needed to write a statement for this work. And I had written this statement, and I was calling it from within, and I pretty much was describing the images, but not really describing or talking about what they meant to me in a personal way and what they were trying to express from a personal standpoint. And part of that, I think, was because when the work first started, as a lot of my work does, I see what's emerging out of the things I'm shooting, as opposed to going, now I'm going to work on this project that has this idea. It's more like, oh, hey, there's something bubbling up here, and let's keep going with that and see where that leads. So I wrote this statement. And at the last Photo Lucida that I was at, I spent some time with Aline Smithson from Lens Scratch. And she's seen my work actually over the last 10 years and given me a lot of great advice. And she really pushed me to think about, what is this work about? And what is all your work about? Because she was like, I'm seeing these themes. And I went back to my room that night and I changed the title and I rewrote my statement and I rewrote my artist statement about my work, because I was like, oh my God, she's right. And what happened is all my work comes from the fact that I grew up military and that I didn't have a home. You know, we would always go to Texas to visit my grandparents, but every year, every couple years, every 3 years, we moved. And so the ground was shifting. The thing, you know, just when I thought I was somewhere home, it would shift. And so these images that resonated with me in the fog, because once you get to what you're seeing, it's not what you saw 20 feet ago. And it changes and it shifts. And that feeling is what I'm trying to capture in this work. And that may be why I'm still struggling with the presentation, the final presentation of it, because, I mean, I guess I'm pretty settled. I've been in the Bay Area for 20 years now. So, but anyway, that's, you know, the work and that working through what it means and how to present it and how to best find the process to represent that work wasn't necessarily always just about the work. It was about how I talk about it too. And that's it.
So I hope everybody had a good time. Yeah, great. It was, yeah, I'm really pleased with how it came out. Until you hear each speaker speak, it's a little bit of a wild card. And I think it all worked out pretty nice. I mean, it's just being honest here, right? It all looks good on paper, but I'm really pleased with how everything worked out. Now, also, a little, I don't know, this isn't really an advertisement because I don't need to entice you to this. If you're attracted to alt photo, historic photo, what did Quinn call it? Whatever you want to call it, processes that are a little bit out of the mainstream, where especially where there's a print that you produce with a tactile quality to it. That's kind of, I guess, what I'm defining alt photo as. We do meet the Center for Photographic History and Technology Pacifica chapter. It's both, the two main population bases are in Seattle and in Vancouver, and there's some other people spread around in between there. But we meet two or three times a year. We've been on a cadence of three times a year. I might shift that to two times a year, and we get a little bit more attendance because there's only twice a year, probably around like April and October time frame. And it's, we usually have a guest speaker. We don't have a bunch of guest speakers. It's just like about 3 hours. And it's the same kind of idea. You bring your work, you show it, you talk to people about it. We have a guest speaker, we learn something new. That's what we do. So if you're interested in that kind of thing, you don't have to commit now, just potentially. What I'll do is I'll add your names from our registration base. When you're registered, I've got your email addresses. So I'll add you to the list, and then you'll see, I'll email about here's when we're potentially going to meet, here's the time and the place, and so forth. And if you're interested, come. If not, that's okay. Just all up to you. So I just wanted to put that word out there that those meetings do happen. And again, it's on a much smaller scale compared to this. We do the symposia every 2 years. But, you know, two or three times a year we meet on a regular basis. So if you're interested, come, please.
More than welcome to come here and check out the pictures. We want to thank Bow Photo for sponsoring. We want to thank all our speakers, Blue, Quinn, Claire, and Ed, Aaron for all those talks in the last couple of days. We thank for everyone who shared in the print sharing room. Did you guys do the print exchange? Did that happen?
Yeah.
Perfect. Some people did it. Perfect. Beautiful. You got something interesting, something cool and creative to take home with you. If you cross the border, don't declare it. Somebody already stopped earlier, apparently. Okay. Sure. Yeah, that's it. That's the ticket. Yeah, that's the way to go. Thank you, volunteers. Stephanie, Kayla from Langara for helping out. Thank you for Darren for getting them over us. Thank you for Maisie for doing the tintype station in the beginning. Great stuff. Thank you, Ed, Judy, Matt, Bruce, for taking care of some stuff up front, helping move stuff around. Thank you for Joan. Thank you for Craig. Thank you for David, who's in Iceland photographing cool things, so he's not here. Let me think. Cool. Thank you for Wayne for taking the doing all the camera work. He's been doing all the behind-the-scenes stuff, so we're going to get some interesting promos for the next events coming up, I believe.
And
thank you, Phil.
Yeah. No. Not a problem. I only fell asleep once, and that's it. Yesterday, that was it. Okay.